Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today we are continuing our series on leading ladies with a controversial leading lady, Imelda Marcos, and her longtime political opponent, Corazon Aquino. We're making a drink called a Coconut Palace in their honor. We're actually making two drinks, a Coconut Palace and a Coconut Floating Palace. To make the first, our alcoholic drink, you will need some coconut rum, some Kahlua, and some root beer. To make our Floating Palace, a non-alcoholic drink, you will need the root beer as well as some coconut cream and some coffee ice cream. While you go wrangle all of that up, I am going to start the stories of Imelda Marcos and Corazon Aquino. Imelda was born in 1929 in the province of Leyte in the southern part of the Philippines. It's a poorer province, but by the time she was a teenager, she had left Leyte and she was living with some wealthy family in Manila. Now, Imelda was a beauty queen, a legitimate beauty queen. She was named Miss Manila in 1953. Now, this meant that she had no shortage of boyfriends. One of them was Ninoy Aquino. Ninoy was a well-known journalist and political activist. He came from a prominent family and was one of the most eligible bachelors in Manila. Their affair was brief and allegedly ended because he felt that she was too tall. He went on to marry Corazon Aquino. She was an intellectual like Ninoy from a prominent family just like he was. She was attending law school when they met, but after a brief courtship, she quit her legal studies and she married Aquino in 1954. That same year, Imelda met Ferdinand Marcos. Ferdinand Marcos was a congressman and considered to be sort of a war hero. It would later come to light that his war record was mainly fraudulent, and before the war, he'd actually been convicted of killing someone in a mafia-style assassination. It's a whole other story. Anyway, I just wanted you to know who Imelda was getting into bed with. And getting into bed she did, because 11 days after they met, the pair was married. So these two women, Imelda and Corazon, or Cory as she was called, were cast in the same role but took wildly different approaches. As Ninoy climbed the political ladder from advisor to mayor to governor, Cory was his support system. She was the mother of his children. She was, as she would say, just a simple housewife. She didn't like to get on stage with him during political events. She would stand in the back, in fact, and watch him speak. And she did support him, of course. She made sacrifices in other ways. She adapted to provincial life, moving from the city to be where he needed to be for his career. And she also supported his early campaigns financially, using money from her inheritance to fund him. Imelda took the exact opposite approach. Imelda virtually orchestrated Marcos's campaign. She went to every single campaign event with him. She would get up on stage with him and sing folk songs and talk to the people about how she had come from a poor background like them and inspired them to become as beautiful and successful as she was. She helped deliver Marcos, her home province of Leyte, and the south of the country, virtually handing him the 1965 presidential election. Again, two women, same goals, wildly different approaches. We are making two cocktails, same goal, deliciousness, somewhat different approaches. We're gonna start the same way on both cocktails. We're gonna take our glasses. I'm using a stemless wine glass, and we are going to put a coconut rim on both of them. These glasses both have pretty narrow mouths, so we're going to be able to use a simple like dip and twist method to rim them. We're just going to dip our non-alcoholic one in some coconut cream, and then twist it into the coconut, giving it a nice equal rim of coconut on it. And then for our alcoholic drink, we are going to dip the lip of the glass into coconut rum, which is honestly a pretty decadent way to rim a glass instead of using fruit juice or coconut milk like we used on the other one. But it seems apropos for the woman that we're profiling. If you know anything about Imelda Marcos, you probably know that she was excessively, unimaginably extravagant. You probably know about her closet filled with hundreds of designer dresses or the thousands of pairs of shoes she owned. You may also know a little bit about the company that she kept. Her husband was always afraid of a coup, so he seldom left the country. Also, he liked to sleep around. He was a winner. So he would often send Imelda around the world on these goodwill ambassador trips. So she met with leaders from every possible walk of life. The good, the bad, and the ugly. Within the country itself, Imelda took on major beautification projects, or as the people referred to them, Imeldification projects. They accused her of having an edifice complex because she was obsessed with funding these massive building projects. One of these projects was actually the Coconut Palace, the namesake of this drink. It was a building that would ultimately, for some time, be the home of the vice president. Let's add the coconut element to these drinks. So, for our alcoholic drink, our Coconut Palace, we are going to add 2 ounces of coconut rum over ice, though. For our non-alcoholic, we are going to add like 2 tablespoons of a heavy coconut cream. Try not to act too surprised when I tell you that Imelda's spending was built on a foundation of embezzlement and massive corruption throughout the government. Of course, this led to unrest within the Philippines and ultimately rioting in the streets. There was tremendous criticism from their political opponents, and the loudest voice speaking out against the Marcos family was Ninoy Aquino. Ninoy was incredibly popular with the people of the Philippines and seemed poised to win the 1972 presidential election, which Marcos, by the way, couldn't even run in because the Philippine constitution prevented anyone from holding more than 2 terms in office. Well, what's a despot to do? Obviously, he had to dissolve the constitution, dismantle Congress, and enact martial law. For 8 years, he and Imelda ruled over the Philippines like a dictatorship. Now, Imelda has said publicly that the years of martial law were the best years in the Philippines because everything was beautiful and peaceful. During this time, the Marcoses are believed to have conducted 3,200 extrajudicial killings, that they tortured more than 35,000 of their citizens, and that 70,000 citizens were jailed without cause. Among the first to be jailed, you guessed it, Ninoy Aquino. While Ninoy was in prison, Cory acted in solidarity by not attending any social events, preventing her children from attending parties. She stopped buying any new clothes or going to the beauty parlor. 7 years into his sentence, Ninoy had a heart attack. He was told that he needed to have a coronary bypass, but he didn't want to have the surgery in the Philippines because he feared that the Marcos' corruption extended all the way into the hospitals and that he wouldn't be allowed to survive. So Imelda herself, the beautiful one, as he called her, came to his bedside and offered to send him to the United States for the surgery, under the condition that he and his family never return to the Philippines. Aquino took the deal, but he never really intended to hold up his side of the bargain. 3 years after he and his family were essentially exiled to the United States, he heard that Marcos was in failing health, and he decided to return to the Philippines in order to reestablish democracy. He knew that this was a risky enterprise. He wore a bulletproof vest on his flight and joked with reporters that wasn't going to do much good if they shot at his head, which they did. The second that Ninoy stepped off the plane, he was assassinated and he died on the runway at Manila Airport. Because at the time, her husband, Ferdinand Marcos, was rejecting a kidney transplant, many people believe that the order came directly from Imelda. After her husband was murdered, Cory returned to the Philippines and became a political activist, speaking out relentlessly against the Marcos' regime. As tensions rose between the people of the Philippines and the Marcos family, the United States eventually stepped in. It should be noted that the U.S. had essentially propped up the Marcos family. Remember, they came to power in the 50s, the height of the Cold War, and the Philippines was a beacon of democracy in the middle of a sea of communism. So the US reaches out to Marcos and says, dude, looks like things aren't going great in your country, so we need for you to have a free and fair election to prove that you are actually the guy who should be in charge. Marcos concedes, he says, fine, and throws a snap election, and his opponents nominate Cory Aquino to run against him. Now, Marcos launches some pretty brutal attacks of Cory in the media. He calls her out for having no experience, which she admitted she did not. She had no experience cheating or lying or stealing from the people of the Philippines. He also said that she really was just a woman and probably more suited to the bedroom than the presidential palace. Cory, who believed that Marcos was really just a feeble front for his wife Imelda, said that she hoped the best woman would win. Now, the best woman did, of course, win, but in a dictatorship, that doesn't matter. The election was incredibly corrupt. It was full of voter suppression, coercion, and even bloodshed. However, an electoral commission that was in Marcos's pocket declared him the winner. This led to the People's Power Revolution, days of civil disobedience and unrest throughout the country that ultimately led to the Marcoses having to flee the palace. They were lifted by helicopter and sent to the US. After the Marcoses were gone, Cory was inaugurated as the 11th president of the Philippines. She was hailed across the globe as being the leader of a bloodless revolution. She was the first female president in Asia, and she became known as the mother of democracy, which she restored. She threw out martial law. She built a legit cabinet. She helped create a new constitution. And she created protection so that in the future there would be free and fair elections. She didn't have any experience, but like her husband, she was grounded in the belief in democracy. We are going to add a grounded or ground element to our cocktails. We are going to add to our alcoholic cocktail 1 ounce of Kahlua. And then to our non-alcoholic floating palace, we are going to add some coffee ice cream. The coffee flavor should go really nicely with the coconut. Both coconut and coffee are, of course, major exports from the Philippines. Much like the Marcoses ended up being. Ferdinand Marcos ultimately died in Hawaii in 1989. Now, immediately, Imelda wanted to return to the Philippines so that she could have her husband buried in Heroes Cemetery, which is where other past presidents of the Philippines are buried. Cory said no to this and made it clear that Imelda was not welcome back in the Philippines. In spite of this, Imelda returned to the Philippines in 1991. She wasn't jailed or exiled. That's Imelda's style. It's not Cory's style. Many people in the Philippines believe that it's incredible she was allowed to return. What I think is interesting is that both of these women wanted to return in spite of the danger. Both of them at different points were exiled from their countries and were desperate to return to their roots. We are adding some roots, some root beer, to these cocktails. We're gonna top our alcoholic cocktail and our non-alcoholic cocktail with some root beer. And we're gonna give them a taste. All right. I'm gonna try our alcoholic one first. I'm gonna give it a little quick spin too. Make sure the elements are mixed together. We can't shake it because it's carbonated, but we can give it a spin. Oh, it's really nice. Get a lot of the coconut, of course. The coffee subtler. And now, the floating palace, that creamy color we get in there. This one's nice too. You get a lot more of the coffee in this one. The coffee ice cream is much stronger than the Kahlua. Mm. Both are delicious. Similar components, but very different outcomes. Now, there is a little epilogue that I think is important for this story. Cory died from cancer in 2009. Her son was president from 2010 until 2016. He was replaced by Rodrigo Duterte, a strongman candidate who was evidently backed by the Marcoses. The Marcoses are still in politics. Marcos's daughter is a governor. Her son, Bongbong, is an ally of Duterte's. Duterte has made it clear that he hopes Bongbong will succeed him in the role of president. Duterte ordered that Ferdinand Marcos' remains be interred at Heroes Cemetery. Meanwhile, Imelda is still alive. She's 93 years old, and from 1995 until last year, she served in the Congress. This is just a reminder that the reason we share these stories is so we are not destined to repeat them. I hope you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back tomorrow. I'll have another lady, another libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls. Come on.